Everybody.
Welcome, Senator Cantwell.
Yeah, great to see everybody. Sorry we're a little late here. We've had votes on the Senate floor and in committees.
We understand the business of government is an important priority.
Yeah.
Well, so thank you everyone and welcome to this virtual RFF live event, The Future of America's Public Lands and the Outdoor Recreation Economy, featuring Senator Maria Cantwell. I'm Richard Knoll, I'm the President and CEO of Resources for the Future. So thanks so much for taking the time to be with us. For those of you who aren't familiar with RFF, Resources for the Future is an independent nonprofit research institution based in Washington, DC. Our mission is to improve environmental, energy, and natural resource decisions through impartial economic research and policy engagement. One of the ways we do this is through virtual RFF live convenings like this one, where we bring together leading experts to develop new shared understandings in crucial policy and economic arenas. So we're very pleased today to be joined by Senator Maria Cantwell. Senator Cantwell has served as a United States Senator for the state of Washington since 2001. She's the ranking member of the Senate Commerce Committee, and she sits on the Senate Finance, Small Business, and Indian Affairs Committees. Senator Cantwell is also a senior member and former ranking member of the Energy and Natural Resources Committee, where she's focused on accelerating our nation's transition to a clean energy and preserving public lands for their social, cultural, and ecological benefits. To that end, she's been a longtime champion of policies like the roadless rule, which protects inventoried roadless areas of the National Forest System. Her bipartisan efforts to permanently reauthorize the Land and Water Conservation Fund was enacted into law in February 2019. And she's also, very importantly, one of the architects of the Great American Outdoors Act, which was passed by the Senate just last week, and which we're going to hear more about shortly. We couldn't be more pleased than to have Senator Cantwell here with us today to discuss what she sees as the future of our public lands and parks. So Senator Cantwell, a hearty welcome to you. Today's discussion will be moderated by one of RFF's senior fellows, Margaret Walls. Margaret is herself an expert on public lands and conservation funding, and she's written extensively on topics relevant to the Great American Outdoors Act and the Land and Water Conservation Fund. One recent study of hers, which was published in the journal Science Advances, analyzes the local economic impacts of national monuments in the American West. Now, a few housekeeping notes before we get started. This is a public webinar, it's being recorded, and it'll be posted on our website afterward. All the audience members are muted and invisible, and you should only see the panelists on your screen. Lastly, if you'd like to join the conversation on Twitter, please use the hashtag RFFLive. So with that, I'll now turn things over to Margaret Walls.
Thank you, Richard, and welcome, Senator Cantwell. I'm so excited to have you here today. I wish we were in person, but nonetheless, and these are issues near and dear to my heart. So this is great to have this conversation. If you don't mind, I'd like to begin, just make sure our audience knows about the Great American Outdoors Act and the two key components of it. So let me just explain that as background, and then we'll get into a discussion about it and other issues. So the Great American Outdoors Act, for everybody that doesn't know, has two main pieces to it. One is creation of a dedicated fund from energy leasing revenues. And that fund will be used to help to clear the deferred maintenance backlog on our public lands in our national park system and in other public lands. The second component is full funding for the Land and Water Conservation Fund. And I hope that we'll spend most of our time talking about that. It's important to understand that that's a fund that's used for federal land acquisitions, new conservation, and also for state and local parks. And now it will be funded at its full $900 million a year level for the first time really in history. So great, I just wanna jump in first and ask you let's talk about, I think maybe the deferred maintenance money first, if you don't mind. I know that the land and water is an issue near and dear to your heart, but on the maintenance backlog money, so the current maintenance backlog of the National Park Service is $12 billion. This fund will create a total of $9.5 billion, if I've done my math right, over 5 years. So I'd just like to ask you sort of, you know, how do you think that money should be spent? What are some of the priorities? You know, how important is this in actually solving some of the problems we have, not only in our park system, but in other public lands agencies?
Well, I think for people throughout the United States of America, if you visited one of our national parks, you can see that there's infrastructure there. There's roads, there's bridges, there's buildings, there's trails. And just like any other valued piece of property or land, it needs uptake. And for the state of Washington, because we have two really big parks with the Olympic National Park and Mount Rainier, I can tell you that it seems like there's an endless list of things that need to be repaired. But I mean, you can have, you know, damages to roads, you can have outdated infrastructure, and all of it needs an upgrade. And that is what the maintenance backlog is for. And it really helps us continue to keep the access to the public. And when you don't make those improvements, literally, you can either have a less viable experience, or as I said, have to curtail services. And that's not something we want to see. We've seen that our national parks are a great economic resource for those regions. I can tell you people in Pierce County and people out on the Olympic Peninsula can tell you the value of having a national park in the backyard and all the businesses and services and tourism that come around that. So it's almost like we had to own up to the fact that that maintenance backlog had grown so great that people we weren't putting the resources into maintaining it. So that's what the backlog of maintenance was about. And I think there's a long list of things that people have already put forward across the United States. So we can kind of see what the list is. Yep. And so it's diverse, I should say. It's diverse in the solutions that it will provide. But the American people should feel confident that the outdoor economy is a juggernaut, that it generates, you know, just behind healthcare and finance, the largest economic numbers for our nation. And so if you keep the maintenance and upkeep, you're going to help keep that investment up, as well as the great experience we want people to have. So it's money well invested, and glad we're getting it done.
Great, I agree with you. And so let's turn to land and water. People have tried for decades, Senator Campbell, to get full funding for a Land and Water Conservation Fund. I followed these issues for many years. Why do you think at this moment in 2020 we were able to get this bill passed? I'm just really curious about that. What do you think are the forces that led to that?
Well, I think you have to go back to the origins of the Land and Water Conservation Fund with Scoop Jackson, which I always do, not just because he was the author and from our state and played such a pivotal role on a lot of environmental issues, but because you wanted to see what they were thinking. And literally, they really expressed this issue of the urbanization of America brought on by the highway system, and that with urbanization, you were going to see the need for open space. And it makes total sense now that we see what did happen with the highway system being developed across in various places. I mean, you know, in my state, you definitely can see how our highway system really helped the population explode. So the issue was, let's set that aside. And so, yes, you're right. People as far back as Jeff Bingaman and Max Baucus and others had tried to say, well, wait a minute, like we need the money to be there and it needs to be fully funded, because that was the intent, even at its passage, was that that amount be fully funded towards land and water conservation, not drifted off into other parts of our right. federal budget. But I think that I would say a couple of things that I think, first of all, there's a lot of great advocacy, and everybody who's listening should pride themselves on the advocacy for public lands, because it really does matter, not only in participating in debates like the monuments issue, or writing your congressperson or senator, those things are all valued, but also just reminding people of the value of public land in your local newspapers and in your community, and talking about those issues, because these are public policy issues. So I think that that advocacy had been a vocal group for a number of years. So basically they were doing all that work and educating people about why we should continue to fund this investment. And so the advocacy grew and grew and grew. And of course, the results grew, right? Land and water conservation. We had a lot of great examples. People were like, wait, this is terrific. You know, it's funded out of this, you know, offshore leasing revenue, and it's being put back into our communities, into public space. And my gosh, look at what it's created for our community. So that built into a pretty big coalition of people who were enthusiastic. But I do think a couple of things in the last few years, changing the focus to the economic value of public lands, the outdoor industry really kind of like also has grown up. I mean, we would say it's been there for a long time with REI, but it's definitely grown up into a very big sector of our economy. And their report about the economic value of public lands as juxtaposed to say mining or you know, other activities was really became a centerpiece of the debate. And so now we were putting this into terms that I think a broader spectrum of our colleagues could relate to. And they basically realized they couldn't just turn us down based on the fact that, oh wait, there might be a better use for this land, or there might be some other, you know, jobs at stake. We came with the jobs agenda, and it was a much bigger agenda. But I do think we also have to consider something else as I look at my colleagues. I do think the urbanization of some of these states, you know, and the activities of encroachment onto things that citizens in North Carolina, or I would say in my state in Southwest Washington, or, you know, where you really have, you're starting to encroach on this public land for that is valuable for hunting and fishing. I think people started to see that. And so now we took states that maybe in the past hadn't been that enthusiastic about land and water conservation, like North Carolina. And now all of a sudden we had an advocate and a determined advocate in Richard Burr. And he did a very effective job of showing his Republican colleagues that he would hold up any bill until we got Land and Water Conservation Fund permanently reauthorized. And that was a change. That wasn't, we didn't usually see that on that side of the aisle. You might have seen it on our side of the aisle, but he became a viable, a very passionate advocate. And again, my guess is it made sense because of the groups in the state and the advocacy they were doing. It made sense because North Carolina was continuing to grow in population and they probably value that. And because we were making a good economic case.
Yeah. I want to come back to the outdoor recreation economy in a minute, but I just want to say a little bit more to make sure everybody understands, like you, the value of the Land and Water Conservation Fund stateside program, that there is a park, at least one park in every county in the country that has funding from the Land and Water Conservation Fund. I just don't think enough people know about this program, I gotta be honest. And 42,000 projects across the country. And I don't know, to me these days, and I'd like to get your reaction to this, with us all stuck inside, and there aren't very many places we can go, but we can go to parks, we can go to the outdoors. And so I guess to speak to not just the economic value, but really the social value, the inherent value to people, as you said, in urban areas and everywhere else, from these resources, which the federal government has helped fund.
Yeah, I definitely think that's, you know, for us, it was Gasworks Park, which is in downtown Seattle. And I remember Congressman Dave Reichert and I and Sally Jewell did a press event there talking about how we needed to reauthorize the Land and Water Conservation Fund. And so I think they are these iconic places, whether you know, in, you know or not in your state, you know the value of that park. You might not know how it got funded,
exactly,
but you definitely know the value of that. And so I think that really did help people, you know, in you know, understanding the land and water conservation. It probably still isn't as a title, you know, truly understood that this is what helps fund your neighborhood park. But to me, I do think there was an underlying tone here that helped us. Mm-hmm. A little, if you would say, a little push down the river. And that was that, you know, America really did need a break right now from COVID.
Yeah.
And the notion of public land and being able to get outside was valued even higher right now than maybe it would have been at some other point in time. People really, really understood the respite they were getting from being able to go out there and one of the few activities that they were able to do. So I think the value did rise during COVID.
Right, I agree. Well, let's talk a little bit more about the outdoor recreation economy. I think you would probably agree. I feel that public lands are the linchpin here for driving that recreation economy. I always like to say we don't have any sales of tents and kayaks and so forth if we don't have public lands and waters where we can use them. But our public lands, many of our public lands have a multiple use mission. So they have resource extraction activities and outdoor recreation and livestock grazing, and a lot of things go on our public lands. So I just wondered if you could talk for a moment about if there's a tension there and how you see that multiple use mission playing out. Sort of where do you see in 2020 and going forward the values of our public lands and how we kind of navigate this multiple use situation?
Well, I would hope that this passage of legislation solving these two problems and basically making a major investment in public land will help stimulate further conversations. So what else could we be doing? What else should we be doing? But I think that it created almost a new day in the discussion. You know, before it was, you know, obviously concerns about degradation of the environment or whether we're actually getting the royalties that the American taxpayer deserves. You know, these questions about usage. But I think now people have said, well, wait a minute, we definitely aren't for the degradation of clean air and clean water and public space that we hold so dear. But are there, you know, other things that we should be doing or could be doing now that we know in real economic terms how much the American people value this experience? And, you know, that is something I think that we have to consider in public land. So yeah, there are things that we're disappointed about, you know, the fact that we wanted, you know, I think started in the Obama administration to reevaluate coal leasing, you know, in Montana and do a new assessment. And then that got shelved in the Trump administration. I mean, I think there's really important issues about the oversight, you know, and stewardship on those resources. For example, just whatever, I think it was yesterday, we asked about, you know, this excessive flaring of methane, big issue. So why are we giving people access to public lands and then having, you know, excessive methane flaring? So I do think there's a whole question to the multiple use issues that are coming more into consciousness and the public debate as people bring these issues to the public's awareness. And I think that will continue as well. But again, as I said, I hope that we now come to this debate and see the value of public land in a new light. And I mean by that, the not just the outdoor experience, which I totally value, but the economic return that we also get from it and the ecosystem that represents to many jobs and to many businesses.
Mm-hmm. So you don't think there's anything on Congress's, what is the next issue on Congress's plate here, do you think, that with regard to public lands? Is there something you'd like to see changed or any big legislative efforts that would sort of take us in a new direction? Or
I'll just have to say, you'll have to wait and see.
Okay. Very good, very good. Well, Richard mentioned at the beginning that we did a national monument study last year, and that study was a fairly rigorous data intensive analysis that looked at the local economic impacts, we're back to the economy again, of national monument designations. And the findings in that study were that monument designation, you know, there's a lot of contentiousness around these sites. Sometimes local communities push back and there's mixed feelings about them. We found that monument designations were mainly positive for local economies, increases in jobs, increases in the number of establishments, no negative effects, some zero effects, but mostly a boon to local economies. So I guess I'd just like to have hear your reaction to those findings and to just protected sites more generally, wilderness areas, national conservation areas, and the role that they play, again, in a multiple use mission. But what is your feeling about those protected designations? Like,
well, I'm very frustrated that we have an administration that does not respect the designation of those monuments and in trying to use it in reverse. And I think this is a prerogative that's been there for presidents. And yes, you have these discussions with various communities. We've had some big discussions in our state, Hanford Reach being one of them, the designation of, you know, a stretch of river through the Tri-Cities area, definitely not met with all of the unanimity that you would want to see on that issue at that moment. And really want to applaud Senator Murray and others for supporting it. And yet that designation during the Clinton administration, I think people now look back and say, oh my gosh, so glad that we did that. Mm-hmm. Or more recently, my colleague, Congressman Larson and I on the designation of various aspects of the San Juan Islands into part of a national monument. Again, not total unanimity by everybody about whether we should do that or not. And yet the notion that that might be thrown into sale by the federal government, you know, put a lot of us at concern about what might happen to it. And if in fact it did go that route. And so we definitely wanted to protect and preserve. So I think, you know, if you look at how many designations have been made by how many administrations over the year, you just want to thank all of them. You really want to thank all of them for preserving for all of America and for future generations, you know, that great experience. And to me, that's what's so special about it, that, you know, that you can have the same experience that, you know, your parents or grandparents or great-grandparents had of visiting this unique place and seeing the grandeur and the beauty of it. And we have a saying in Washington, you know, environmentalists make great ancestors. And the point is that, you know, you might get irritated once or twice at something, but you basically are really grateful that they fought for those things for the next generation.
Mm-hmm. Very good. I'm mindful of your time. Do you have a hard stop at 4 o'clock, Senator Cantwell? Is that the?
I'm not sure where I'm pulled next, but I'm sure that's probably right. So.
Yeah, I wonder if we have time for a question or two from the audience. Do you have 5 minutes maybe for that? Or?
Go ahead.
Okay, let me see what we have here. Well, here's a good question. Somebody says, congratulations on your historic win for America's Outdoors. Full and permanent funding for LWCF will go down as one of your greatest achievements. Thank you. In terms of growing and maintaining support for conservation, what are the most important lessons you learned in this multi-year campaign? I guess for going forward for, you know, there was bipartisan support, we got it over the finish line. I guess, are there some lessons learned there?
Well, first of all, again, thanks to the extraordinary advocacy by lots of people who do this on a constant basis. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And that's a very long list of groups and organizations and people and all of that. Yes, bipartisan and talk about the economic value. I just think that gets us onto the debate that you know we want to have. And I think that, you know, when we're approaching these things in the future, you know, look, to me, it's always this big question. You know, I think about all these debates I've been in part of since I've been in the Senate. And, you know, I mean, you know, they kind of were this, you know, I remember the big debate between, you know, Ted Stevens and
I think. Have a little frozen screen, Senator.
Thank you. No.
Senator, I don't know if you can hear me, but you're breaking up a little bit. maybe have some internet problem, connection problems.
About the area, yes.
Okay, can you hear me now? I'm afraid we had a little bit of connection issues there. I wanted to read another question that somebody sent, if you're available for that. I think we may have some problems here with the some connection issues, Senator.
And in the near future. Thank you.
All right, thanks everyone. I think we had some, sorry about the technical difficulties at the end. We see so the rest of the questions here, a few of them we can type some answers to. I want to remind everybody that the video will be up, and I'm sorry that the Senator had more limited time today than we initially hoped, but thanks again for joining us.